In the last chapter, we discussed well-ordered sets. It is such a set that transfinite recursion can run through all of its elements, even though it doesn't cover the full world of transfinite recursion. It makes sense that some well-ordered sets are longer than others, that the transfinite recursion will run on them for a longer time in some sense. We start this chapter by examining this comparison in more detail. Let's take two well-ordered sets and run the transfinite recursion simultaneously on both of them. That is, we set the zero case at the same time, then we proceed with the first successor step at the same time, the second one, and so on. We stop at the moment when one of the sets is filled. Either the recursion fills the entire second set and the proper initial segment of the first one, or vice versa, the first set is filled and some bars of the other one remained, or the transfinite recursion finishes both of them at the same time. This simultaneous recursion gives us something more than just the final result. For every processed element in the first set, there is a corresponding element of the second set. That means that we can align these sets so that they look the same. This appearance up to alignment, which is the same thing as the length in transfinite recursion, is measured by so-called ordinal numbers, shortly ordinals. Here we have another view of what this represents. If there is an order-preserving matching between two well-ordered sets AB, that is without crossing, we say that their order type is the same ordinal number. The existence of such a matching is equivalent to the property that we can align the sets one above the other without reordering. If, on the other hand, we match the set B just with a proper initial segment of A, we say that the order type of A is bigger than the one of B. You may have registered the similarity between this and cardinal numbers discussed in chapters 2 and 3, so let's look at it. It is similar, but still quite different. We say that two sets A and B are of the same cardinality if there is a perfect matching between them, just that this time we don't care about the ordering of the elements. We can reorder the set A and it still represents the same unordered set A with having the same cardinality. The ordering here is just our visualization, it doesn't represent an inner structure of the set. On the other hand, ordinals measure ordered sets, and they carry information about the ordering. So for preserving the ordinal type, we're just allowed to shift the bars, but not to swap them. In the finite case, it is the same. If we shuffle elements in finite ordered set, it doesn't change its ordinal type. There are still 5 bars in one line. We identify finite ordinal numbers with finite cardinal numbers, so the ordinal type of that set is 5. But in the infinite case, it is easy to reorder a well-ordered set to obtain a well-ordered set of another type. The cardinality is still the same, but the ordinal type has changed. That's because we have to examine all the possible matchings to assure whether the two sets have different sizes. It is not necessary for ordinal types. There is just one possible order-preserving matching with an initial segment, the one given by the simultaneous transfinite recursion. And then, there are different motivations behind the abstractions of set sizes or order types. We introduced cardinal numbers for the investigation of sizes of different sets, such as natural numbers, integers, rational numbers, real numbers, and so on. But ordinals are not primarily intended for examining different well-ordered sets. They rather extract the essence of well-ordered sets. They are useful for focusing on what is essential on the well-ordering property. The ordering itself, not the underlying set. So from now on, we will use ordinals instead of well-ordered sets. We will draw them in the same way and the meaning is virtually the same. Just keep in mind that the ordering is the only thing important here and we don't change the ordinal number by adjusting the bars a bit. Now let's try a bit circular idea and let's construct ordinals by transfinite recursion. The base case is the empty ordinal 0. We represent it as an empty brace now. It is a bit weird well-ordered set, but it is technically correct. There is no infinite decreasing sequence in the empty set. In the successor step, we add one new element to the end of the previous ordinal, so-called plus one operation. This produces ordinals 1, 2, 3,
4, and all the natural numbers.
The limit step is something we will call the ordinal union. Let's return to the idea of the alignment of ordinals. When we have two different ordinals, then one of them represents just an initial segment of the other. The ordinal union is the operation that aligns them in such a way and merges them afterward. So the ordinal union of two ordinals is actually not very interesting. It simply returns the bigger ordinal number. But the definition align to the left and merge works even for an infinite number of ordinals. So in our case, we take all the natural numbers, align them to the left and merge them. The set of all the natural numbers was chosen to represent this ordinal number, so we call it omega. Then we continue again with the successor step and get omega plus 1, omega plus 2, omega plus 3 and so on. The limit step again applies the ordinal union and creates an ordinal called, reasonably enough, omega plus omega. Technically, we should also take the finite ordinal numbers when taking the union, but they don't make a difference and they don't fit into the screen. Well, we cannot really boost our ordinal construction by this approach. We need the underlying ordinal large enough in the first place. However, the nice thing here is that we have labeled the elements of the underlying well-ordered set by other ordinal numbers. Ordinals play two roles. They either represent order types of well-ordered sets or indices of their elements. There are several ways how to see this correspondence. By the construction, the position of an ordinal, say omega plus 3, is the omega plus 3 successor steps from the first point. So the index meaning represents the ordered number of successor steps from index 0. Alternatively, every such step can be identified with its starting point. In that case, we see the ordinal omega plus 3 as a proper initial segment, and the point indexed by omega plus 3 is the successor of such an initial segment. This is a bit different from the usual ordinal numbers in natural languages. It can be confusing. When we talk about the fourth element in the natural language, we mean that we take four elements as an initial segment and then pick the last of them. But this approach cannot work for set theory. Some initial segments, like omega, do not have their last elements. That's why it's better to pick the successor which is guaranteed to exist by the well-ordering property, even though it may seem unnatural at first. Alright, ordinals can play two roles, either order types of well-ordered sets or indices. But indices of what exactly? It turns out that it doesn't really matter. Every ordinal can play the index role somewhere, in any larger ordinal. If we are interested just in the outcome of the transfinite recursion at, say, point 4, it doesn't matter how long the underlying set is. The recursion runs 4 successor steps to that point every time. So ordinals represent indices of a universal well-ordering. Ordinal numbers form the world of transfinite recursion as particular points of it. This world of ordinals is unlimited. For some reasons, which will be discussed in later videos, we are not even allowed to make a set of all of them. But it doesn't prevent us from running a recursion on all the ordinals. At the end of the video, let's look at the ordinal union operation from the perspective of indices. It is the operation that takes several ordinals, aligns them to the left, and merges them. In indices, this corresponds to the so-called supremum. However, the usual definition of the supremum of real numbers goes as follows. Take a subset of the real numbers, say the closed interval from -2.5 to 2.5. This set has its maximum, that is 2.5. However, not every set has a maximum. For instance, the open interval denoted by parentheses doesn't have any maximum because the point 2.5 is outside the set. But it is almost the maximum, just unfortunately outside of the set. So we call it the supremum, a kind of imitation of the maximum. More precisely, if there is a maximum, the supremum is that maximum. If, on the other hand, the set doesn't contain a maximum, the supremum is the first element after the whole set. And this definition exactly corresponds to the ordinal union. The union of a set of ordinals interpreted as indices is either the maximal index here, if there is one, or the index just after the set.
Next time, we will examine ordinal addition and multiplication and see whether a turtle can catch Achilles. See you then!